To be here again, to be a part of Sabre and to share my life in baseball with you all. And also to, I'm going to also open it up to questions afterwards if you want to ask some questions. But I know a lot of you have been asking questions about the book and how it's doing. Well, the book was inducted into the Baseball Hall of Fame this summer in August. And I was very, very honored to be a part of that. And, you know, it's really funny, when you're a baseball player, you try to get into the Hall of Fame as a player. I didn't really try to get in there as an author, but I did.
Yeah.
But the book is there in Cooperstown now, and it was fun going up there for a week and spending time up there and enjoying it. It was quite an amazing thing to go through. My career spanned for 10 years, about 12 seasons. And I started off with the San Francisco Giants. I was our number one draft pick with them in 1970. And immediately went to big league spring training in 1971 at the age of 19. With a bunch of 36 and 35-year-old guys that were ending their career. So I was like the little brother that was asked to come and join the big guys. And it was a lot of fun. Go drinking with them. I sat alone a lot. It was an experience, but where I gained a lot of respect was on the field. And I'm going to tell you one story that happened in my very first year at 19. Now, keep this in mind. They started me against the Chicago Cubs here in Scottsdale. And we were on the road with them, coming from Phoenix Mini. And my knees were like, shaking. And they all knew it. They didn't laugh, but the other team was laughing. They saw me shaking out there. And they were catcalling me. Hey, rookie, throw the ball so you can hit it. You know, and I'm going, oh, yeah, okay, fine. So, first guy, I walk. And he gets on base, takes off, steals second. Dick Dietz is catching, air mails the ball into center field. Guy goes to third, it's Glenn Beckman. And meanwhile, back at the ranch, before I'm going to back up a bit, but I'm on the mound, getting ready to pitch, and I hear this, hey, I'm not ready yet. I look back, it's number 24. I'm 19, so you know what happened. That's all I forget about it. And so I'm just a mess, nervous wreck. So I got Beckard on third. Willie McCovey walks over to me and he goes, well, you know what you got to do. And I said, no. Oh, yeah, I know what I have to do. Sure. So get back in, settle in a little bit. Don Kessinger's second guy up. And I had my way with Don. He struck out. Next guy comes up is Juan Santo.
Wow.
And I'm going, oh, that's Juan Santo. I called your brother Don Kessinger. Well, here you go, Mr. Santo. This is from John Giacosto to you. Shoo, boom. Right in the rib cage. Down he goes, on the ground. Yeah, got dead quiet when I met him. And I looked over at him. And I said, nobody said a word. Santo got up. Went to first base. I got out of the inning with him. It was dead quiet. I got in the dugout and I feel this little pat on the head. Turn around. Anyways, Bobby Barnes hugged me like this. McCovey come over. Gave me a hug. I thought you'd be out to take care of business. We go, yeah, Stretch, got it. It was like I was a little kid in a gang that just stole his first car. Okay? And everyone's sitting there patting you on the back, right? Okay, it was the most awesome thing. But from that point on, I was accepted. And that year, I almost made that team. not made it. They wanted me to go, but a lot of the coaches said, no, he's not ready yet, and they were protecting me from going early. A lot of guys like David Clyde had hurt his arm, blew his arm out, you know, and a lot of other pitchers that I came up with had blown their arms out, so they didn't want to do that with me. So they sent me to the minor leagues, and I go 15 innings, 239 pitches. Next week, I go 14 innings, and then 220, and it's like,
Yeah.
Where's the pitch count? He's a number one draft pick. If you did that in today's society, and Mr. Heeman knows, you get your butt fired. Okay? Because it just never happened. But anyway, that was one of the classic stories that I had. It's in the book too, and it was a fun part of my career, my start in my career. But one of the classics was, and I'll never forget, was pitching against the great Bob Gibson. And this was very interesting, to say the least. This is with the Giants, when I was at the Giants, and we were in St. Louis, and Gibby gave up 5 in the first, I came out and gave up 4 in the first, and so the score was 5-4. So, all of a sudden, things kind of got sobering. And Gibby comes up to the plate. I throw a curveball at him, and I knock him down. And I turn around like this, and Chris Spire comes running in, and he goes, "That wasn't a fastball, was it?" No, it wasn't. You're a dead man. And I said, "Yeah, go away." So Gibby's looking at me like a fireman. I mean, he just, blood coming out, you know, he's spitting at me, and he's like cussing me out, you know, and I could see it, and I go, okay, can I get rid of him? I lead off the next inning. First pitch, right here. I had flashbacks for 2.5 years of a ball in my face. I don't know how I got away from this pitch. I threw my legs out from underneath me, and my butt hit the ground hard. My helmet came off my head. The ball hit the helmet, cracked the helmet in half, and it hit the ground. I went to go look at my helmet, and I looked up at him, and he went like this. And I went, oh my God. He's not done yet. And he wasn't. Next inning, he came up. I knock him down. Next inning, he came up. He knocks me down, I get up and get a base hit right past his head. And I'm at first base, and he turns over and looks at me, and I said, "Oh, now I'm dead." This went on all game. We retired 19 in a row, the two of us together. And I beat him 5-4. He got taken out early. And at the end of the game, there's an elevator at Busch Stadium, old Busch Stadium. It's called the back elevator. It's called the escape elevator. It's where you can escape, get away from the fans if you don't want to sign autographs. Well, I ice my arm down and go into the back elevator, and I get on the other door's open. And I look in the corner. There's this mysterious dark figure.
Gibby!
Yeah, you got it. And I go, what are you going to say? Okay.
I'm saying the next one.
What are you going to say?
Beat the hell out of you, didn't I?
So I walk in and I go, "Nice game, Gibby." He goes, "F you." I said, "Well, F you." We're going F you back and forth.
He said,
"Hey, enough of this. Who are you to talk to me like that?" He goes, "You should respect me more." I said, "F you." Back and forth. I get in his face. He pushes me. I grab his arm. Well, as I grab his arms, he's pushing me, and I hit the door. The door opened. Down we go. I flip him over. The doors are going like this. All my teammates are out there waiting for me because we're going down the marathon. So get dinner. I have a few drinks. And we're screaming at each other, break us up. He walks off, he turns around, "I'll see you next week." And I go, Oh yeah, you'll see me next week. Well, sure enough, next week came. And this time, the battle was on. I never got knocked down so many times in my life. On one individual, I thought the man was gonna, I don't know how I dodged him. I don't think he was really trying to hit me. I think he was just trying to knock me down. But he drilled me, and I drilled him. And let me tell you what, when he got up, he looked at me and he goes like this.
No more.
Went 9 innings, and I lost 2-1 to Ramirez.
Wow.
And that was his last year. So to be able to have, later on, to have him as my pitching coach, with Atlanta, when I go down to Joe Torre as the manager, Joe calls my dad calls me, I go to San Diego Stadium, and I'm on the mound, and I feel this tap on my shoulder, and I go, I know it's you. He goes, yeah, you're right. You still got your slider? I go, yeah, I still got my slider. Well, show it to me. On my slider. He goes, oh, that's good. Here, let me show you since you're with us now. I go, nobody said anything about contract. He goes, nope, you're with us. Here, hold it this way. And I threw that slider, Bob Gibson's slider. And, you know, to have that happen, and I go, Gibby, you remember the game? And go, oh, yeah, I remember the game. You remember that? Yeah, yeah, I remember that. Look good. Still buds? Always were. No one challenging me like that. And I said, that's great, because I still will. And he just laughed. He just laughed. But it was so good to have him, you know, as my coach. And so, you know, very nice to meet him, you know, to get to see Bob Gibson. But, you know, it was a fun travel. And in writing the book, you know, a lot of books are written about superstars and how good they are and what they did in their careers. But nobody really wrote a book about a journeyman pitcher. You know, what they go through just to stay on the field. What they have to do to physically keep themselves in shape. What ups and downs they go through. The divorces, the family problems, everything that comes all in one package and gets thrown at you. And all you can do is sit there and say, I'm lucky to be here. I'm thankful to be a major league player. I'm thankful to be on this field playing against a lot of Hall of Famers. And, you know, I played with now 12 because Timmy Raines. Timmy Raines was an addition of the Hall of Famers. I played with 11 and Tim is 12. And it's such a good feeling to have as a ball player to know you played with such greats. From Willie Mays to Timmy Raines. You know, and it's like everything in the middle. It was great. I played with Gary Carter, Dave Winfield, you know, and a lot of guys that didn't make the Hall of Fame that were great players, like, you know, Greg Nettles, for crying out loud. You know, like, guys like that, you know, it was a super time, but you really had to give it your best, and the best effort that you had to give, and the dedication you had to just stay there, fighting arm injuries, you know, second guy to get to Tony Jones. You know, it's hard to go through. You see your career going away. It's dissipating in front of you. And Pat Riley was sitting there when I talked to Frank Jobe and Dr. Curley. And here I am with the Dodgers doctors, and I go, hey, are you guys going to carve me up like a steak or what? You know, I am a giant, you know. And they go, oh, no, we'll take good care of you. You know, and sure, yeah, right before surgery, he's going, are you hearing me? Frank Jobe was a character. He's a great, great doctor, a great guy. But that kind of scared me. And, but he did fix me. He did fix me, and I was able to keep my career going for like quite a while. But, you know, these are the things that you deal with in baseball, but then you also deal with things in life. And I ended up dealing with some pretty serious stuff in my life. And was able to fight it and conquer it and come back and make something out of myself. And now I live for Major League Baseball. I work for Major League Baseball MLB Network, and I work for MLB.com. I'm one of the few people in the business now that does both. So I do the instant replay with the umpires. But I handle all the ballpark cam interviews that you see on MLB Network. So when you see that interview, I'm the one that's doing the direction. You got two, three, five, you're all on. That's what I do. So I got promoted. I'm 65 years old and going up the food chain. But anyway, it's fun to be a part of Major League Baseball and to be in that and facilitate my dream to continue my life with MLB.